sense, I'm at least going to start quite gently. So the three parts are going to be number one, definitions, number two, history, and number three, results. And all results that I'm going to talk about are going to be joint with Martin Dereau, Grenoble, and Julien Popper from Arizona State. Okay, so we've already heard earlier on in the week what a lattice is. So a lattice, roughly speaking, is a discrete group with finite covolume. And so in order to make sense of this, I need to have a topology so I can say that I have something that is discrete, and I need to have a metric, or at least a volume form, so that I can say I've got finite covolume. Here, finite covolume. So the usual context we have is if we have G would be a semi-simple Lie group, then we naturally have a topology here, and so gamma sitting inside G is a lattice if this topology restricts to this discrete topology, and we have, maybe we could think of volume with respect to Haar measure, or more usually we would take G over K, where K is a maximal compact. So that would be the associated symmetric space, and then that has a Riemannian metric, and it would be finite volume with respect to that metric. So that's the easy definition. Okay, so we've done lattice. Now I'm going to put my hand over here and tell you what arithmetic means, and then later we'll work out what non-arithmetic means, which is going to be the opposite of arithmetic. And unfortunately, you know, we're only like 2 minutes into the talk, and I'm going to get a little bit technical here. We already heard someone earlier on in the week talk about higher rank lattices, and they said more or less everything is like SLNZ sitting inside SLNR for n bigger than or equal to 3. And that's more or less what arithmetic means, but let me give you a proper definition, and then we'll give an example to see how that works in practice. Okay, so here we're going to have script G is going to be a linear algebraic group defined over Q, which half of the audience start to have heart attacks at this stage, but what does that mean? It means it's a subgroup of, or perhaps of GL, MC for some M, where the coefficients satisfy polynomial relations and the polynomials are defined over the integers. So, examples of what that could be. It could be that the determinant has to be 1. That's a polynomial relation in the matrix entries, and it clearly has integer coefficients. It could be that the matrix has to preserve a quadratic form or a Hermitian form. That's again a polynomial relation in the matrix entries, and it again has integer coefficients. Or it could be that the entries lie in a number field, in which case they would have to satisfy the minimal polynomial of that number field, and that again has integer coefficients. So these are all examples of these polynomial relations. All three of them are going to arise, and that's basically all you need to think about at this stage.
With Hermitian forms, you would have a problem there, yeah? With Hermitian forms, you would have
a problem. Well, you would split it up into real and imaginary parts, because I'm going to immediately go to the real point. But yes, yeah. So yeah, you have to do something slightly. Okay. And so now inside here, I'm going to want to look at the real points. The real matrices, and here we have the integer matrices in G. And this is basically the most abstract way you can think of trying to find something discrete inside something continuous. And it's something that every child from about the age of 5 or perhaps younger knows, that the integers are discrete inside the reals. And that is, so something is arithmetic if it's discrete simply because the integers are discrete inside the reals. Clearly, this is discrete inside here. And so that's my prototypical example of what an arithmetic group should be. But actually, I don't really want to work in that context because this is far too abstract for me. I want to work in something slightly more concrete. And so I need to move from my abstract world to my concrete world. You may not think that a semi-simple Lie group is not so concrete. But and so then if I have phi from GR to my favorite Lie group there, G, which is a surjective homomorphism with compact kernel. And that is going to be the most crucial part of this. Then gamma in G is arithmetic if there exists this big abstract framework, so that gamma is commensurable with phi of the integer points. Okay, commensurability is the natural invariance class when we're talking about these lattices. So let me just remind you what it means for two groups to be commensurable. So gamma 1, gamma 2 in G are commensurable. And I really want commensurable in the wide sense. For those people who know the narrow sense as well, if there exists G in G, so that gamma 1 intersect G, gamma 2 G inverse, so I fix a G and I conjugate my second group by that G, has finite index, both gamma 1 and gamma 2. In other words, I don't mind passing to finite index subgroups or supergroups, and that's so arithmeticity is going to be an invariant of taking finite index subgroups or supergroups. Okay, so let's bring this down to earth with an example. And this example really has everything you need to know for this talk about arithmetic groups. So GL3R, on R3, we consider quadratic form given by x1 squared plus x2 squared minus the square root of 2 x3 squared. This has got a signature 2-1. And so the group of orthogonal matrices preserving this form, so maybe we'll call this Q for quadratic. So SOQ is isomorphic to SO21 in the obvious way, or perhaps maybe even equals that, depending on quite what your definition. And so you could think of this as being the group of isometries of the hyperbolic plane. Now I have this square root of 2 in here, so I want to think about gamma is SOQ intersect SL3 integers join root 2. Now, if I were thinking about what I was talking about previously, about the integers being discrete inside the reals, then I would get discreteness. Unfortunately, the ring of integers in Q adjoint root 2 is not discrete inside the reals, so I cannot immediately conclude discreteness. So I have to do something else. So let's think about sigma from Q adjoint root 2 to itself as the Galois automorphism, which sends root 2 to minus root 2. I then apply this automorphism to everything in sight, and so I have Q sigma . So immediately I see that SOQ sigma is isomorphic to SO3, which is compact. And now if I have A in gamma over there, we can think about A sigma, which is going to be in gamma sigma, which is SOQ sigma intersect SL3Z adjoint root 2. And I want to think about the group where I'm taking the pair A sigma as A. Now, I was unfortunate that Z adjoint root 2 was not discrete inside the reals. However, if I were to take the pair A plus B root 2, AB, Z, so this is a thing in Z adjoint root 2, and I would take its Galois conjugate, that pair, as A and B vary over the integers, is discrete inside R2. Because I could just think about it as A times 1, 1 plus B times root 2 minus root 2, and I get a picture where I have something like 1 root 2. I sort of have points that go up here. I have sort of a rectangle of size root 2. And I get a sort of a diagonal lattice sitting inside R2. So this means that if I look at this pair A sigma as A varies over gamma, that is going to be discrete inside inside whatever it was. So this means that this sort of A sigma A gamma, so the union of all of those, is discrete in SOQ cross SOQ sigma. So that's a discrete group, that's good. And now I can take my projection map, which is a projection onto the first factor. So phi send a sigma to A, just projection onto the first factor. The kernel of that sits inside SOQ sigma, which is compact, and therefore my group gamma was in fact discrete after all, and is an example of an arithmetic group. So Kerr phi is compact, and that implies that gamma is discrete. And that's a prototypical example of an arithmetic group. Actually, technically, it's arithmetic groups of the first kind. There is a second kind. I'm not going to go into the groups of the second kind at all today. So that was my series of definitions. So I've defined for you lattice, which we had earlier on. I've defined for you arithmetic group. So now let's think about some history. Arithmetic groups are lattices. That's due to Borel and Harishchandra. I have to make sure my dashes are of different lengths. Maybe I put a comma there. Yes?
When you set up the first kind, is that like in the sense of Lindbergh?
I mean, what do you mean by in the sense of Lindbergh? So there were two sorts of... So arithmetic of the first kind is where you have a Hermitian or a quadratic form. Arithmetic of the second kind is where you have a different sort of involution on your group.
I had looked for that definition actually, and the source I could find was Lindbergh, where he discusses it, and I was always wondering where it originated, if it was a Borel thing or if it was some more like folklore notion kind of thing.
I guess Borel is probably that would be my guess. Yeah.
Sorry, is this related to this finiteness theorem of Borel and all the time?
Well, I'm not sure. I don't.
So then, if you fix the genus, there are only finitely many.
No. I mean, this is. So they. From the construction, they're discrete, and you have to show that they're finite covolume. We had a reference to that earlier on in the week. So you end up, it's quite a delicate thing that you actually have to show that you have a finite covolume. Yeah. Okay. Right. So second. All lattices are arithmetic. Well, if I stopped here, there would be nothing to do for the rest of the talk. It would be a vacuous talk, and you may as well all have had some more coffee or perhaps some more margaritas, if you're young enough to have margaritas at lunchtime. So I need to say except when G is commensurable to SON1 or SUN1. And this is due to Margulis for the higher rank, and to Corlett, and to Gromov and Shane for the the other rank 1 groups. So the other rank 1 groups would be SPN1 and the exceptional group corresponding to the octonionic hyperbolic plane, which is F4 minus 20. Okay. So So from this big world of all semi-simple Lie groups, I've boiled it down to my two favorite families of Lie groups, namely the isometries of the hyperbolic plane and the isometries of hyperbolic space, I should say, and isometries of complex hyperbolic space. And this is where the rest of the talk is going to live. So what about showing that since all arithmetic except for that case, well, what about these two cases? So there were some easy examples for small values of n, and then there were more examples for particular values of n, but eventually there's a whole family, so there exist non-arithmetic lattices in SON1 for all n, I guess bigger than or equal to 2, and this is due to, this is another place where I have to have two different lengths of dash, Gromov and Piatetsky-Shapiro. I should also say that there's a completely different construction that works for all n due to Bela-Lipetsky and Thompson. I'm not going to talk about that, but that's a second completely different construction. So now we've dispensed with SON1. We're coming back to SUN1. So what happens there? Well, SU11, well, that's commensurable with SO21, so we perhaps could have already thought about that, but I just want to briefly mention what's going on here. There's an expensive way and a cheap way to get non-arithmetic groups here. What's the cheap way? Well, the cheap way, we have Teichmuller space, so we have a continuous deformation of lattices. We can only have countably many arithmetic groups, and so there must be non-arithmetic groups. That's not very helpful. It's cheap. A slightly more expensive way would be result of Takeuchi, and I guess this is 1977, who tells you exactly which triangle groups are arithmetic and which ones are non-arithmetic. So. In particular, there's only finitely many arithmetic triangle groups, and so there's a specific list of infinitely many different, I guess, even commensurability classes of lattices here.
Is there a formula that the angles have to satisfy?
Well, there's a list, and it is. Arithmeticity is something you cannot detect using geometry. It's if you were a little ant living on the surface defined by or orbifold defined by your group, you would not be able to tell whether you were arithmetic or not. It's sort of not in the realm of geometry. It's really something in the realm of number theory, and it's this sort of very strange interaction between geometry and number theory, which I find particularly appealing, and why I think it's an interesting subject. So SU21, Mostow in 1980, it's a fantastic paper. It's 100 pages long. In the Pacific Journal, it gives you basically background for everything. Almost everything I'm doing, you could trace back to the different parts of that paper. It was also a pioneer in the use of computers in doing mathematics. So he did a lot of computer experiments, and I guess that must have been in the 70s, and computers were a little bit less sophisticated then. So it's quite a tour de force, that paper. So he gave 6 examples. And I think Misha Kapovich described this as geometric geometry, or he was a geometric geometer. So this is geometric geometry going on here. It's polyhedra, lengths, sides, angles, all the things that a school child who did geometry would know as geometry. Livnay, 1981, one example. I think he didn't actually investigate its arithmetic nature, and this was using algebraic geometry. Deline and Mostow, 1986. They gave a whole family of examples of different lattices, some of which were arithmetic and some of which were non-arithmetic. I'm just saying more. I'll say more precisely about this in a second. And this is using moduli of hypergeometric functions. Hypergeometric functions in several variables. And in fact, the groups that were considered here go back to the work of Picard in the 1880s, but nobody had ever thought about their arithmetic nature. And more or less, that's the end of history. There are some more things that happened a little bit later to look at this, but there were no new examples after 1986. But let me just give you a little more history. Oh, I should say here, I can put SU31 here, because what Deline and Mostow give a single example in there. Thurston, and this was his shapes of polyhedra. Herzebruch, line arrangements. I guess I should also put Tirada here somewhere earlier. So these groups have been described from at least three different, very, very different points of view. It's a very interesting phenomenon. Perhaps the more recent history is that. Well, actually, before I say the more recent history, Deline and Mostow give exactly one example in SU31. To date, that is the only example that's known. There's one example known. Oh, and I should say then, SUN1, n bigger than or equal to 4. There's been various false examples, but it is, as I speak, I believe, still open. And somebody has described it as the most serious open problem in Lie theory. I don't know whether that's really true or not, but I have heard it described that way. So let's carry on with the SU21. So this is work of Capes and Muller and McMullen from around about 2012-2013. There are 9 commensurability classes of Deline Mostow lattices in SU21. Right? So Takeuchi gives me infinitely many with n equals 1. Deline and Mostow give me 9 examples when n equals 2, and 1 example when n equals 3, and nobody knows about higher values of n. Okay? So I think that was all for my history lesson.
Is any of this list exhausted?
No. Yeah, so there's an open question, do there exist infinitely many non-arithmetic lattices? My belief is that the answer is yes, but I don't know. So then we come on to the third part, results.
Mostow of lattices are those they constructed using modular hypergeometric functions.
Yes.
It's like an intrinsic statement, like whatever that they are doing.
So you have a particular hypergeometric function. So that would be, so you have path integrals between certain points in the plane, and then when you move your path around, then those integrals form a vector space, and then when you change your path, then you get a linear map on that vector space, and that linear map, for some reason, actually is not just in SLNC, it's in SU. N1 or for some values of n, and then actually it gives you a lattice. So results. So this is with Martin de Rolle, Julien Popper, 2016. We're following on from some earlier work of ours, but there are at least 22 commensurability classes of non-arithmetic lattices. In SU21. So history stopped in 1986. People were looking for more examples, and well, we found the first examples since that time. And not only have we found, so there was a paper that was published earlier this year where we gave the first examples, there were five examples there. We have more examples now, and we've actually divided them into commensurability classes because it was not clear whether they were commensurable or not. So that is a definitive result, at least. And we can't, I mean, I think we've more or less exhausted our method. So how are we doing? I've got another 20 minutes, is that right? So what I want to do is I want to talk about the work of Mosto from here, and how our work generalizes his work, and how we come about some of this. So from now on, the whole of the talk is going to be in SU21. So how do I tell whether a lattice is arithmetic or not? Well, I've given you a definition of arithmetic, but how do I know something is non-arithmetic? So here's a theorem of Mosto, and it follows earlier criteria of Takeuchi and Winberg. Which says, so let K be a number field, and OK, the ring of integers, H, a Hermitian form, defined over K with signature N1, and gamma sitting inside SU of H, so unitary matrices preserving that Hermitian form. We possibly don't need S in there, but it's just useful to keep it there. A lattice. And I should say SUH with entries in O. That means preserving the Hermitian form matrix entries in the ring of integers. Then gamma is arithmetic if and only if for all sigma in the Galois group of K, H sigma is positive definite, negative definite. Well, that's clearly false because I have the identity, so I want sigma does not induce the identity. Right, well, where do I want that? I could really say I don't want it to induce the identity on K, but then I could produce silly examples, because I could actually have a number field that was far too big and do something silly there. So I want to have the smallest number field that's going to be in this context, and so that's going to be Q adjoin the trace of the adjoint representation of gamma. It's the smallest number field, and this number field is given to you by the group. You could say, well, perhaps I've just chosen a bad number field. Maybe the same group is arithmetic over a different number field. This number field is given to you, God given to you. You can't do anything other than that. Okay. And so this is if and only if. So if somebody gives you a lattice in this framework, and you find one non-trivial Galois automorphism where your new Hermitian form is indefinite, then your lattice is non-arithmetic. So actually, this is the easy part. This is like a little simple exercise in linear algebra once you have your lattice. The hard part, and I never even said that here, that's the hard part. Why is it hard? It's hard because if you're in a situation, so suppose there exists sigma non-trivial such that H sigma is indefinite, then SUHOK is not discrete. Right? If you were in the case where it's arithmetic, then this whole group was discrete. Just using the same argument that we had earlier on for my example, but in this case it's not discrete. So gamma has to be infinite index in this group. So it has to be very, very small compared to this group. However, we want it to have finite covolume, so it has to be very, very large. And it's the tension between this small and large which means that these groups are actually quite hard to find. Good. Right. So I want to start now to talk about the work of Mostow. And for that I need to talk about complex reflections. Let's just think about for a moment what a real reflection is. And this is linear algebra, okay? So suppose that I'm in n plus 1, and here is a hyperplane, Rn, through the origin, and I have a point up here. Maybe we could even say C. Well, no, let's we want real reflections. We'll have Rn. So here is my point X. I want to reflect, and I also should have a unit. I should have a normal vector here. I want to reflect X in the hyperplane. What do I do? Well, we this is what we teach our students in linear algebra. We decompose into something in the hyperplane plus something in the normal direction. We then multiply the thing in the normal direction by minus 1, and I would have R of X. And this vector here becomes X dot N over N dot N times N. So this one is X minus X dot N over N dot N times N. And so that means that R of X is X minus N dot N, or X dot N, sorry, over N dot N times N minus X dot N over N dot N times N. That's the formula we give to students for reflections in linear algebra. Now what happens if I'm some blue chalk here? Camouflage, as somebody said, if we put Cn here. Now we have a complex hyperplane, so I can draw a complex line there. Now I have lots of choice for my reflection, because what I can do is I can just rotate through an angle theta here, and that would be r theta of x, right? And of course, this should have been Cn plus 1 here as well. And that means that in this case, I just put an e to the I theta there. So that's the formula for my complex reflection. Now, I just did it with a dot product. Of course, we're working over a Hermitian in a product, so I can just put Hermitian products everywhere. And then this is going to be in un1. I really wanted sun1, so I can just multiply by a scalar to get myself into sun1. But this is a complex reflection. With angle theta. Now, you might object. You might say reflection should always have order 2, and if my angle is not equal to pi, then this has not got order 2. In particular, it could have infinite order if theta was an irrational multiple of pi. I agree. It's not very satisfactory, but it's a convention that's used. Shepherd and Todd were classifying finite groups generated by complex reflections way back in the 50s. I think there's nothing I can do to change this, so you'll just have to forgive me, and we'll have to work with complex reflections like this. Okay, so I also will call this, for obvious reasons, the mirror of the complex reflection. So what did Mostow do? Well, he considered three complex lines in, okay, I just realized I haven't told you what complex hyperbolic space is. Let me do that, I'm sorry. So complex hyperbolic space is going to be the symmetric space associated to SU21. So we quotient out by the maximal compact, which is S of U2 cross U1. We can think about this as the space of negative lines inside C3 minus the origin, equipped with this Hermitian form, in which case we get something like the light cone, a sort of a complex version of this light cone, and it would just be sitting here. And so we can think of it, if you want, as being like B2 sitting inside C2. If I did it in one dimension, I would exactly get the Poincaré disk. So there's a sort of a philosophical point here. The Poincaré disk or the upper half plane are really models of complex hyperbolic one space, whereas the Klein-Beltrami disk or the hyperboloid model are real hyperbolic two space. Because if you want to generalize them, they generalize in different ways. Just like if you think there's this low-dimensional accident, that S2 is the same as CP1, but if I generalize to SN or CPN, then I get different things. It's the same way. I'm generalizing the hyperbolic plane, but in a complex way. I lose some things. I lose constant curvature, but I keep complex structure. So there's a sort of a give and there's a take. Okay, so what does Mostow do? Mostow thinks he takes three lines, L1, L2, and L3, sitting inside H2C. So these are complex lines. And he considers the group generated by complex reflections fixing those three complex lines. These are the mirrors of the complex reflections. So he considers Ri, a complex reflection with angle 2 pi over p, with mirror Li. P is an integer, not necessarily a prime. And so we have a situation like this. Use the assumption that the intersection points all lived inside complex hyperbolic space, and furthermore that there was a threefold symmetry. There was an order 3 map called J, which cyclically permutes them. So J of Li is Li plus 1, and so this means that J R1 J inverse is R2. J R2 J inverse, which is J inverse R1 J is R3, so J cubed is the identity. Now he also ended up putting a further assumption. He assumed that these reflections satisfy the classical braid relation. Ri, Rj, Ri is Rj, Ri, Rj. I mean, effectively, what's going on is he was looking at the subgroup of SU2, or U2, sorry, that fixes each of those points, and this relation would be in there. When you come to the monodromy of hypergeometric functions, this is going to be corresponding to braid groups, and so you would naturally expect this relation.
For all choices of
P. No, he chose P. So P is one of the pieces of data that he gives you. I mean, at the moment I'm thinking about this abstractly, and I can think of any choice of P. But then he's going to tell you which P are going to work. That still doesn't determine my group. With all of those restrictions, there's still a one parameter family of such groups. So there's still a one parameter family. And I'm not going to quite go into what he calls his phase parameter, because I'll give you a slightly different interpretation in a second. But then he constructs a family of 17 groups for particular values of p plus this phase parameter. So he gives you 17 groups with p is 3, 4, or 5. with this phase parameter, the particular phase parameter. So what do? Well, our first work we did was we forget about that assumption. And then that gives us now a two-parameter family. And we then looked at, and we found more examples. In fact, we found 10 more examples where we forgot that. So then we decided we would forget this as well. And that ended up giving us 3 more examples. So it turns out that you can characterize each of the groups by them satisfying certain sorts of generalized braid relations. So I want to say that, and I'm going to give you a list of the possible braid relations that we have, and then I'm going to stop. So we do not have this braid relation, or sometimes with the threefold symmetry. However, it turns out that in our groups, that we do have Ri and Rj, or Ri and Rj, Rk, Ri inverse, do satisfy generalized braid relations. And actually what these relations are characterizes the group. So what do I mean by a generalized braid relation? So I'm going to say that BR of A and B is equal to N if I take a sequence AB up to A or B at the end is the same as BA up to B or A, and the total length here is N. So for example, BR of AB equals 2 if and only if AB equals BA, so they commute. BR of AB is 3 is ABA is BAB. You can guess what's coming. I'll just do one more. ABAB is BABA. And so on. And you get the general drift. So here are the groups that we have. I'm just going to give you 22 of these. So I'm going to have values of P. There'll be different values of P for the same braid relations. So I'm going to have braid relations of, I'm going to abbreviate 1 and 2, that would be R1 and R2. Braid of 2 and 3, braid of 3, and let me do it in the same order as I have here, otherwise I'm going to get lost. 2, 3, 3, 1, 1, 2, braid of 1 and 2, 3, 2, braid of 2, 3, 3, braid of 3 and 1, 2. So we have, for the Mosto, we always had 3s in each of those positions, and his first example had 3s in that position as well, and here P was 7, 8, or 10. He, And here we have 5 or 6. So this is Musto. This is Livnay. This is Lena Musto. So these were the examples that were known in 1986. So let's now fast forward onto this board. And I'll write these numbers up and then I'll stop. I'm sorry, is that okay? This is where I wish I was doing this on a PowerPoint, because I would just have had all of these already. So same conventions there. 4, 4, 4, 3, 3, 3, and here we get the most possible of all of the things. These are 4, 5, 6, 8, and 12. So here are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 new examples of non-arithmetic lattices. And with that, I'll stop.
Question, please?
Yes.
So just to be sure, so you construct these groups, and then you get the Cartesian product in the same way that you do it for C squared of 2.
To prove discreteness,
we build a fundamental polyhedron.
Then you get
So we have an algorithm that works for all of these groups here, and plus a lot of the arithmetic ones. I tried to do a count up just before this morning at breakfast time, and it's almost 100 groups this algorithm works for. Where we show how to build polyhedra. So there's a new sort of tile that we would have, which would be for the different sides of the polyhedron. Motivated by some work of Rich Schwartz, but we build these polyhedra. And if I had a little more time, I could tell you how to do that, but I don't. And there's an algorithm that works. There's a lot of things to check. And so Martin de Roo has a computer program that will check all of these things. Every one of those things you could quite happily check by hand, but it would just take a little bit of a long time. So I mean, it's not a computer-aided proof in the sense of like that, the four-color theorem. It really is
Many of them look like equilateral triangles.
That's right.
So that means that the polyhedron that you get are very regular.
That's right. There's more regularity there. Yeah.
Any question?
I suppose you can never get the finite group like that.
Well, we can construct finite groups like this, but they won't be lattices, because they would have to have we want finite covolume. But we can certainly, within these families, there are some groups that are sort of smaller than that, which are finite groups, and so they're not interesting to us.
Okay, thank you very much.
So we resume at 1 o'clock for the last week.